بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا مولانا محمد عليه وعلى آله أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. I ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to keep us all in the best of states of iman, in the best of states of health, and to give us the best of أخلاق يا رب. آمين. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى give us the ability to see truth as truth and give us the strength to act upon it and to live by it and to practice it and to showcase it and to model it in everything that we do and everything that we say يا رب. آمين آمين آمين. And I just want to take this as an opportunity also to make dua for the people of Afghanistan. May Allah make it easy for them, Ya Rab. And the people of Kashmir and the people in South Africa and Yemen and everywhere else in the world where the Muslims are struggling. Too many names to mention. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for everybody, Ya Rab. Ameen, ameen, ameen. We're discussing in this series ways to find, halal ways to find love. Halal ways to find a partner to spend the rest of your life with. And in the episode before the last episode, we discussed the basis of marriage and the blessings associated and the virtues and the merits associated with marriage. And today, inshallah ta'ala, I would like to focus on the practical ways of finding love and finding it in the halal. The first thing that I want to mention is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ, and tell the believing men, and also وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ, and tell the believing women to lower from their gaze, to lower from their gaze. What does that mean? Let me give you a good example. And Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the beautiful, during the ceremony of Hajj. He was during the Hajj with his companions. And one of his own cousins, Al-Fudayl ibn Abbas, imagine his own family member, a young man, he was in a situation where he's sitting or standing next to Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and one of the young women comes to ask the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a question. Now, when she's asking this question, she happens to have a share of beauty. She's young. So Al-Fudayl ibn Abbas's attention is caught and he looks in her direction. So Nabi ﷺ notices Al-Fudayl looking. He doesn't tell the woman to dress differently. He actually pushes the face of Al-Fudayl away. So she's wearing her hijab, she's covered. He pushes the face of Al-Fudayl away. This happens once, it happens twice, it happens three times. And every single time the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ pushes the face of Al-Fudayl away from the, from looking at this young person, this young female. And then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam commented at the end, and he says, I did not want for fitna to basically, or for, the seeds of temptation to grow in either of their hearts. I wanted to basically keep the two of them protected. And I want you to imagine, this is in the time of Hajj, in the companionship of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, involving a member of a Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's own family. So the space is the most beautiful of spaces. The time is the most beautiful of times. The company is the best of companies. But still, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told the two, especially the guy, to be careful, to be cautious of the fitna. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, one of the things that I fear for my ummah is the fitna of wealth and the fitna of temptation, especially, for men who are tempted, with lust and desire when it comes to the opposite gender. And of course, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the hadith, he says, whoever protects this, whoever protects what's, in between their lips, their tongue, and what's in between their legs, their private parts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's incumbent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them Jannah. So it's such a difficult fitna for many of us at different phases in our lives. Sometimes when you're young, it's more, subhanAllah, tempting. And sometimes after you're married, it's more tempting for different people. But at different phases in our life, it is a temptation that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to be cautious about. So the first thing that I want us to remember is you're not going to find the halal by consuming the haram. And consuming the haram will push away the rizq that is written for you in the halal. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, وَإِنَّ الْمَرْءَ لَيُحْرَمُ مِنْ رِزْقٍ بِالذَّنْبِ يُصِيبُهُ وَإِنَّ الْمَرْءَ لَيُحْرَمُ مِنْ رِزْقٍ بِخَطِئَةٍ يَعْمَلُهَا. There are two different narrations there. And one of them is stronger than Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us that the human being will be prevented from the risk that is written for him or her through the sins that he or she commits. So I want you to imagine every gaze that you look at, the haram, could be taking you away from the halal that is written for you. Every single sound that you hear in the haram could be taking away the sound of halal that is written for you. Every tongue, word that you say, every action that you take, every word that you type, every phrase that you share in a chat, private or not, if it's not in the halal and if it's haram, it could be taking away from the halal that is written for you. So the first way to find halal love is to cancel all the noise. Don't think to yourself that, oh, I'm going to find, you know, that I'm going to, you know, I'm going to start off, you know, with this intention or that intention and justify and rationalize. No. Be very clear from the beginning and make the boundaries as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you for them to be. What does that mean? Concretely, it means that I'm not going to engage in a friendship or I'm not going to have a relationship with somebody outside of the covenant of marriage. And I'm not going to let it get intimate to a point where we're sharing our, you know, secrets and laughing and joking and getting really emotionally attached. And a lot of the times people think about zina as only physical. Oh, we didn't commit the act. But zina could also be emotional as well. Like zina could be when you have that connection with somebody and you have that reliance on somebody and you have that dependence on somebody to a point where you're feeling emotionally void by not being in that person's presence, by not having that person with you. That in itself is supposed to be limited within the covenant of marriage, within the boundaries of marriage. So when you're relying on somebody physically or relying on somebody emotionally, those two things outside of the covenant of marriage, that is clearly mentioned in the Quran and clearly mentioned in the Sunnah of the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that this is haram. This is not to be accepted. And of course, it doesn't matter who rationalizes it, who justifies it. It doesn't matter how many people accept it. The way of the Muslim person, the way of Islam is very clearly defined. So the first thing that I want us to remember is that you will not find the halal by pursuing the haram. And you will not justify the haram by saying it could eventually become halal. And this is a slippery slope that a lot of people fall into. So don't say, yeah, I know, Sheikh, it's haram. Or I know it's not the best relationship now. But we promised each other marriage. We're working towards it. Right now, you know, I'm a student, she's a student. We just want to get to know each other a little bit. And then eventually, inshallah, when Allah wills, we'll get married. You're not married. So don't act as if you're married until you're married. Don't build a life based on a hypothesis, based on a hypothetical situation and a scenario, right? Either you make it so that you're able to get married now or you remove, you know, that communication channel and that connection until it's very clearly, again, defined that you're ready, both of you are ready. Now, what are the parameters then? How does somebody look for marriage? How does it work from an Islamic point of view? From an Islamic point of view, there's a general rule, which is, you know, come to the house from the front door. وَأْتُ الْبُيُوتَ مِنْ أَبْوَابِهَا. Even though the reference in the Quran is about something else for Quraysh, the meaning is still valid. Meaning that you find somebody that you're interested in, be very, very, very honest with yourself. Am I ready? Yes, go ahead and pursue. Knock on the front door, speak to the father directly, or if you're a sister, let your family know that you're interested in this individual. Maybe let a friend know. Do the background check. Do the references. Look into this person's habits, characteristics. Test them from afar. Do a background check on them by asking their friends, asking their teachers, asking the people that are aware of what they're like, that know them well. And then once you see that some form of compatibility, what you do is you make that connection publicly, respectfully, meaning publicly with the family, right? You let the family know and you sit down for an honest conversation during which you get to know each other. You get to know each other. So what are you like? What are you looking for in a husband? What are you looking for in a wife? How what are your pet peeves? What things would work for you? You know, one of the exercises that we do at the masjid, let's say, for example, a sister doesn't have a wali, doesn't have a father or a mahram present. She comes to the masjid and the imam serves as her wali. She comes to us and says, listen, I have this individual in mind. Would you be able to serve as my wali? Especially if she's a revert, a newcomer to Islam. So what I do at the very beginning, after, you know, two meetings of them just getting to know each other a little bit, maybe by the third meeting, second meeting, I will ask for both of them to do a job description for the other. What are you looking for in a husband? Give me all the qualities that you need. 2 pages max. What are you looking for in a wife? 2 pages max. And that gives you, again, concrete expectations from both sides. And it gives you an idea of what the person is looking at in terms of what to expect from their potential spouse, what to expect from their potential wife or husband. So this is, again, one of the ways that this can happen. You can get your family involved. You can get your local community involved. You can get your local imam involved. You can get somebody in the community that you respect involved. And then, of course, there are cultural barriers that sometimes happen along the way. Oh, my father doesn't want me to marry this guy because he's Arab and I'm Pakistani. Or my father doesn't want me to marry this girl because, you know, we're Pakistani and they're Arab. Whatever is going on there, if you feel like some of the things that are being done, that are being practiced, are un-Islamic, are culturally grounded but may defy what is clearly mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah, then at that moment you can get your local imam involved to speak to the father, to speak to the family, to try to, you know, kind of get everybody on the same page and get them to reconsider some of the assumptions. But then, of course, this is again a very, very last resort card that I don't wish for us to use unless absolutely necessary. And the advice that I generally give to our young brothers and sisters is do a Venn diagram. Before you pursue somebody for marriage, do a Venn diagram. What does that mean? I'm going to look at what I need. These are the things that I need as myself, as an individual. And these are the things that my family needs. So I have the things that I need. I have the things that, you know, my family needs. And I have the things that Islam, the Quran and the Sunnah say. So I create a Venn diagram. And where those three intersect, that, you know, 5% to 10% of the population, where the three intersect, that is where I begin to pursue. And my advice for young people is don't find somebody and then later on ask, what will my parents think of this individual? From the very beginning, from the get-go, pull your guards up so that you're filtering out those who will not make it, again, comfortable for the family, and those that will not sit well into the family structure and the cultural expectations at the beginning, from the very beginning. No, they should not be the make it or break it, but they're an important consideration from an Islamic point of view. So to summarize, from the very beginning, go through the front door, ask the family directly, get the family involved. And a lot of us say, well, why should we get the family involved from the very beginning? I'm an independent, capable person of making, you know, capable of making my own decisions. I don't need anybody else to get involved. At the end of the day, we as Muslims, we as human beings, we have our shortcomings. We have our shortcomings in the way that we, you know, perceive in our experiences. And subhanAllah, you before marriage, even 2, 3, 4 years of marriage will transform you through the experience of marriage. So don't take for granted the experience of your parents and the experience of the community. You know, sometimes when a girl and a guy are sitting together, getting to know each other for marriage, there's a lot of exaggeration. The guy will say, oh, I used to, you know, when I was 16, I used to be the captain of Barcelona. And then when I was 17, you know, I was going to be, you know, promoted to this and this and that. And I used to, and you know, a lot of these exaggerations that may not be true. When he's sitting in the presence of your father, that shows seriousness. It shows commitment. It shows that he's not running around or, you know, playing around or looking for something temporary. It shows that he's a man. He's ready to sit down and have a conversation. And similarly, when a sister engages her family, it shows that she's serious. It shows that she's serious. And the context of this conversation happening with the family makes it so that there is little room, a lot less room for exaggerations and misrepresentation and for things to go smoothly and for things to happen, you know, strategically as well. Of course, there are families that can make it more difficult. That is true. And for those situations, we're not talking about the exceptions. We're talking about the general rules. But for those situations, there is a safety net and a network available for you that I would encourage all of you to tap into, which is go to your local imam or go to the community and ask them regarding your specific situation. But to summarize, do not ever justify a haram relationship. Do not justify a secret relationship. Do not justify a relationship that is, you know, virtual or in person, physical or emotional, that is outside of the covenants of the, you know, the marriage and the promises and the vows of marriage, because those are, from an Islamic point of view, considered to be a major sin. وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَيَخْلُدْ فِيهِ مُهَانًا إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Allah mentions that those who engage in this kind of sin, it is a major sin. They will get double the punishment in the dunya, they will get double the punishment in the akhirah. Except those who repent, turn to Allah, start fresh, and replace the bad that was done with good that is to come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to turn to Him constantly for hope, turn to Him constantly for healing, turn to Him constantly for recovery. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow the best of our days to be the last of our days. And may Allah allow us to meet Him with the best of relationships in our lives that bring us closer to Him. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to live upon Islam and to die upon Iman, Ya Rab. Ameen. Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you for tuning in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.